The ancient people of Bolivia are believed to have navigated in boats built of reeds from the interior of South America to the Atlantic. The Kota Mamre expeditions in 1998 and 99 had showed it was possible to voyage by such boats, built in the traditional style on Lake Titicaca, along the Rio Descadera, and also 1,800 miles from southeastern Bolivia to Buenos Aires, probably for the purpose of trade. Throughout Bolivia, there are numerous undiscovered archaeological sites. It is a poor country and could benefit enormously from ecotourism. If a site of major importance, such as Machu Picchu in Peru, could be discovered, it would greatly boost the economy. In order to locate sites, the assistance of local people is vital. To encourage them, the expeditions have included medical and dental teams. Wildlife along the rivers is also attractive for tourists, and biologists compiled reports on conservation issues. Thus, Kota Mamre 3 aimed to carry out archaeological and wildlife studies and prove that traditionally built reed boats could navigate from the Andes to the Atlantic. However, a recce was required, and this took place in 2001. This determined that ruins did exist near the town of Mapiri, not far from Lake Titicaca, and might prove to be the legendary lost city of Paititi that the German photographer Hans Hertel claimed to have discovered in 1954. Hertel had been Hitler's photographer and was extremely interested in archaeology, but strangely his team did not include an archaeologist. The Scientific Exploration Society's expedition set out in May 2001 to examine the alleged site of Paititi. The team, which during a period of 5 months involved over 100 persons, was made up of many nationalities and included a number of serving and retired British soldiers. At an altitude of over 13,200 feet, La Paz is one of the highest capital cities. The drive to the expedition base at Guanay is along some perilous roads. Known as the most dangerous road in the world, this narrow mountain track is the scene of many fatal accidents. As one motors down into the jungle-clad valleys, the heat and humidity rises. There's been no time for the team to acclimatize. That will come later.
Wangasar pasagewanki palomitai
On arrival at Guanay, the team are briefed by the leader, Colonel John Blashford Snell, on the task and the archaeological quest ahead. Meanwhile, up at Lake Titicaca, Jim and Jerry Masters are working with the Qatari family to complete the reed trimaran Kota Mama 3.
And others are getting ready to receive us. And then from Kila Petunia, it's foot all the way. It's about 31 kilometers up to the site. And if you look now at these drawings over here, we've now advanced into the mountains. And here you see where we propose to have the advance base. Here is this great long spur, and the red line shows the approximate route which we're hoping to take.
To the crackle of fireworks, the expedition's archaeological teams and engineers set off for the mountain village of Huila Patuni. The late rains have not helped, and the track is in a terrible condition.
We've just arrived at Kila Petuni after a journey of 7 or 8 hours. We've got maybe half an hour, maybe an hour to put up our tents before it gets dark.
Using pack horses and mules, the teams start the long ascent to Mount Paititi.
This is another mule stop to repack the mules once again. We seem to go about a couple of hundred metres and then stop for about half an hour, and we end up standing here with our packs on. We've just broken out onto a ridge, and there's actually quite a nice breeze, and the view from here is just awesome.
Much time and patience is required to load the pack animals. Royal Army Veterinary Corps personnel and some volunteers from HSBC are in charge of the animal transport.
From San Jose to Warikonga, we were told it would take 2 hours, but it's taken 45 minutes. We could have made it here yesterday. It's a good decision to stop where we were last night.
But the structures that you've seen there.
At the advanced base at Warikonka, John Blashford Snell and the liaison officer, Colombian Yolima Sipagauta, brief the team for the final part of the journey to the site. Pack animals can only go as far as the Rio Chinijo, where the Royal Engineers section is making a crossing. Thereafter, all stores must be carried by porters and expedition members. The first obstacle, after the river, is named Leopold Spur after Prince Leopold Darenberg, who found a way up on the 2000 recce.
We've managed to locate the archaeological site, which some people think is the city of Paititi, and in fact, it's over here in the fold in the hills, where you can see the cloud just lying low in the valleys. And Mike Howe, a former Royal Engineer captain, is up there with an archaeological team, including Bruce Mann from Aberdeen, a young archaeologist, and a team of sappers under Craig Holford. And they're clearing the site. They've already located a couple of artificial mounds about 20 meters in height. They found two or three buildings, lots of walls, a paved pool, a well, and what appears to be a monolith, possibly with some carvings on it. And this is very significant because there's centuries and centuries of leaf mold and mulch there, which of course we've got to get through. But we have found the site, and this is a tremendous achievement for the first people who got up there. And of course, great credit to the Bolivians, because without the help of the Bolivian Indian, Angel, who went up with Mike, I don't think we'd have found it. Now, of course, the big job is to get the stores and supplies forward. And Paul Hortop and his team are working like that, like mad, from Advanced Base, which is over to my left, down the hill, at a place called Wariconka. And that's about as far as we can get most of the complicated and heavy stores. We can then take them forward by mule down to the river crossing we call Smith's Camp, which is down in the dip to my left. And this is a real struggle going down there. The sappers have built an aerial ropeway across the river, which passes the kit over, but you still have to swim through the river. And Paul Overton is manning that camp, and is going to start climbing this very, very steep spur you can see down in the valley. We've named that after Prince Leopold, who found the way up, Leopold Spur.
Most parts of the trail just crossed at Smith's Camp, and this is heading up Leopold Spur. The engineers have spent about 3 days here working on improving the route. Behind me you can see they've had to lay a log across a particularly steep and treacherous section where in fact there's no soil and nothing to hold onto. So they've laid across a log to walk onto and a rope walkway. Greg and I have just brought down two loads of resupplies for the engineers who are working down here at Smith's Camp. They're working on producing a route up the other side there that hopefully the mules will be able to get across. And as you can see behind me here, they've set up two ropeways across the river, one to take stores across and one for people to swim across. And then they've got some of their camp on the far bank over there.
Climb is a real struggle, as is much of the way forward.
And what's really difficult about that is that's the first bit I've been able to film. The rest of it has been too difficult. It is a virtual vertical climb up here. This is the first time going along Leopold Spur I've actually been able to film and walk at the same time. And that's only because we're on a short downhill bit. It's now the 30th of May, and this is the site that greeted us yesterday when we arrived here at Paititi. Most fantastic waterfall in the background. And it's a beautiful site right by the river. There's hardly any insects or anything like that.
2 days' march from the river crossing brings the teams to the site of Ertl's Paititi.
This is the base camp on the River Tulani, where the path that we cut from Smith's camp came out on. This is the waterfall that we found for a start. It's one of three on this river. There's another two just further down. Within the site importance and the location, these waterfalls are quite something. Incas and also the previous civilizations predating them, like the Tiwanaku and that, waterfalls are an important feature within their religious belief and so on. And as you can see, it's quite a spectacular waterfall as well.
Here they find the remains of Hans Ertl's timber frame house, built by him in 1954, and still with a few uprights intact. It is important to find pottery in order to date the site, but strangely only a few fragments are discovered. This creates doubts about Ertl's claims.
What he found and so on. He built this structure, we think, on top of Camp 3. He's levelled it off slightly. There are various features lined roundabouts. It's quite central to the site. And this was going to be his permanent house for when he came back. Unfortunately, he never made it. So this is all that remains. I mean, for 50-year-old timbers, they're pretty good still. We've got remains of tin cans now lying around as well, like Quaker oats and so on. But the fallen steps. They are natural slabs of stone which haven't been dressed, but the way they are lying horizontal, we've also got supports underneath them. They have been actually artificially put here. We've got more stone leading off into the jungle further down. These seem to lead up to this natural rise up here, which has been artificially flattened. Unfortunately, because of Hans Ertl's house being put on top, we've lost some of the detail on that on it. But we're going to clear those off more, and then further over, about 6 meters to the north, we have this monolith as such, a very large stone which you do not find elsewhere on the site, big stones like this. So I think this is the fallen monolith that he talked about in his reports. We've got the fallen steps just over there, and about 7 meters away we have this rather large stone which lies up the slope, goes on for at least probably another meter from where we see it ending, and the vegetation has been cleared so far. There are no discernible features on it at the moment. Until we've cleared it off, we're not 100% sure, obviously. And this, is, I think, is the fallen monolith that Hans Ertl has talked about in the past. I mean, originally, presumably, this monolith would have been upright, either on this raised platform area as such, further up, and it's fallen down this way, but then looking at the way the bases are dropped at the bottom, it's probably more likely to have been upright at the base of the step somewhere in this area, but it's not going to have fallen far because it's too big a stone to shift around, so I think it's probably just tipped backwards that way onto the slope. Called Meditation House. When the initial recce came out last year, they did have a sketch plan that was done by some of the locals who described this place as a meditation house on the edge of the Tilani itself, the Rio Tilani. When we got here, this is what we have found. It is a natural rock overhang with another slab that's broken off and is just propped up on it to form the V in the first place. There is no signs of any working within it or any carving, any soot or anything like that. The trouble is with the strata around here is that it flakes off on flat planes anyway into natural rectangular shaped blocks. Behind it we have the so-called steps that lead up to it. But unfortunately, we're on a cliff anyway, so the end is still 10, 20 feet above the Rio itself. Again, these steps look as if they're just natural breaking of the strata going down. It's a natural formation. What I'm sitting on is, again, could be interpreted as similar sort of steps. But again, it's just natural breakage. This is, again, fairly spectacular in the scenery itself running along. We've got another two waterfalls just a little bit further down from here. This is the only feature on this side of the site itself, on the plateau that we're on, which could be interpreted as a man-made feature, but it isn't, unfortunately. This is the retaining wall for the entrance to the tunnel and the feature that goes off to the right coming out of that tunnel. It is the best bit of wall we have on the site at the moment. As you can see, we have stones going one way, and then the next course down they go in long ways, and then before going back out to the horizontal on this. This is quite a specific type of stonework, and hopefully it will help in the dating of the site as well. There is another wall about 10 metres further down, which again appears to be a similar construction to this. It's smaller, it's about half the size. And again appears to try and terrace what is a natural gully anyway going down. Whether this is to try and channel the water more, or whether it's to associate it with agriculture or something, we're not sure yet. I would say it's probably more to do with the channeling of the water. It seems to be an awful lot of features associated with that at the moment on this site.
We'll see soon the time scale.
Two lapas.
At the moment, this is the only definite structure we have on the site. It's a rectangular building, approximately 9 metres by 4. It is loose dry stone walling. We have this massive great stone in the corner, though, which was either here and they've utilised, because we can't see. We think this is probably a colonial building, maybe slightly later in date. We can't see them shifting this around, because they weren't quite like that. So we think this is probably a natural boulder that was lying on the slope here for a start, and they've just utilised it, propped up in the corner. We've got an interesting feature in that this wall buttresses out a bit further from the stone and then steps back in, which is why we put a trench in here to try and see if we actually have another extension of a room or something on the side of this building, if it's slightly L-shaped or something like that. We had a trench in the centre of it yesterday that the Bolivians put in. We managed to get a couple of pieces of basic pottery out of it, which again confirms the date as being colonial or slightly later. At the moment we have no other finds as such apart from a metal can, which I think dates to Hans Ertel's time.
This is the site that the local people say is Paititi. What we found was intriguing. First of all, we discovered a series of pools, definitely man-made, and these seem to lead down in a type of watercourse towards the Rio Santana. We also found the remains of a large stone house. We found many retaining walls, platforms, one or two huge steps that appeared to lead up to high ground, but no monoliths that we'd hoped to find. And we were told by the local people from Kilipatuni that these had been removed, possibly by treasure hunters. We also found what appeared to be a natural mound. Some people had said that this was a pyramid. I don't think it was. I think it was a natural mound. And it looked out across the valley over towards the far range of the San Carlos Hills. Up on the hill, above this wonderful waterfall that we saw there, about an hour's march, we found what appears to have been a gold sluice, crudely made out of rock and of indeterminate date. And this was the real problem. We found this amazing site. We're not sure whether in fact it was Inca or pre-Inca or what it was, or who made it or who lived there. But the local people's legend is that this was a religious center. In fact, rather more sinister than that, it was a satanic center. And it was here that they came to give themselves power. So Celso, the head man of the nearest village, told us. He said that the people came here to get power to move stones by thought. It's very interesting. The same sort of belief exists in parts of Tibet. And, well, we didn't see any particular evidence of that. But these incredible pools that we found, with the waterways and the drains leading into them, do suggest that it might have been some form of ritualistic center in the middle of what quite clearly was a large agricultural area and a mining area, because we found evidence of the mines, we found evidence of the terraces that had held up the fields, and now, on the way back, we've come to the fort that we discovered on the way in. Now this fort, on which I'm leaning, is quite different. The structure is much more ordered. You can see that the stonework has been more or less faced, whereas the stonework we saw in the retaining walls at what the locals call Paititi was a much cruder and rougher design, possibly earlier. I think, too, that the Spanish were there. I think perhaps the date might have been carved by a Spanish explorer, because it was carved at the point of ultimate exploration. They couldn't have got any farther than the Devil's Cauldron, and so they wrote a date, 1750. And you have to remember that people were still fighting the Incas at that time in this part of the world. And maybe this fort on which we're now sitting was part of the Incas' last defense. The Bolivian archaeologists whom we have with us have already found pottery here. Now this is a great step forward, because at the last site we found nothing. There was no pottery, no ceramics, no artifacts, nothing to indicate who had built it. But here we have pottery, part of cooking utensils, and they are saying that this is possibly a pre-Inca site. And also, of course, it could have been Inca.
So here we have this great mystery. Here was a civilization tucked away in one of the most remote places on Earth. It's really taken us quite a struggle to get in here, and in fact at times I have felt that the trail was not a trail, it was an army assault course. And we've seen the ruins, we know there was a civilization here, and we found what we came to find. The only problem is we still do not know who built it.
Yesterday, the 2nd of June, left Paititi after spending a week working on the site there. Myself and James and the main party of engineers moved to here, which is the fort, and the engineers left here this morning and they're going down to the river to start work on a bridge so that we can get back, avoiding Leopold Spur. It will probably take them 2 or 3 days to build the bridge. In the meantime, myself and James are building a base camp here at the fort to allow the two Bolivian archaeologists to work on the fort here, hopefully find some pottery so that it can date and confirm the site as Inca. Here I am at the bridge over the River Chinijo on the way back to Warikonga from the fort. We're obviously halfway down in the bottom of the valley where this big river is. It's taken the engineers a couple of days to build this bridge. Myself, Mike and Alistair have now got a huge climb up the other side and back up to Warikonga, which we hope to do in about 4 hours' time. Well, after 1.5 hour walking, we've broken out of the tree line and we've now got this fantastic view behind us of the ridge line that we've just left and climbed down to the river and then back at the other side to Inca Pampa. On the way up, we've just passed terrace after terrace that were built by the Incas thousands of years ago.
Big send-off is underway, and I get my first glimpse of Kota Mama 3. She was transported here by the Bolivian army from Lake Titicaca.
We believe that the sort of boats that we have taken down, the reed boat, the Totora, and the Balsa, were the type of crafts that might have been used. But perhaps 3,000 years ago, the ancestors of the people who are watching today went down these rivers carrying gold, bringing back coca.
So, who's John in charge of from the south? Captain Matt Wilkinson, Royal Engineers. Shirley Critchley, grandmother from Poole. Andy Player, builder from Bournemouth. Peter Kanagara, IT expert from West Sussex. Geoffrey Hoskins, accountant from Hampshire.
We thank the prefecture for their very...
John's right-hand woman is Yoli, a Colombian with contacts in the highest places. Everyone has a role.
I'm on one of the hulls as an oarsman, and I'm also the expedition handyman.
With a surge of water, the adventure begins.
Very short rapid.
Next morning, the rapids.
Yeah, the boats are very heavy, and the biggest concern I've got is someone coming off that boat and then getting trapped between the boat and a rock.
We are the first down in the safety boat. The biggest threat is this. But Kota Mama sails through unscathed, and for the first time, we realise this journey really could have been made thousands of years before us. We're travelling about 30 miles a day.
The weather's still hasn't improved. It's much too cold for the Amazon, and we're hoping to get some warm weather in a day or two.
And then, the unexpected.
Is everyone okay? Are you
alright? Right, guys, before the floor.
Well, there must have been some underwater obstruction that we struck. But thankfully, no one fell into the water, which is the saving grace.
Kota Mammoth 3 is based on a traditional design. Indeed, an ancient ceramic model of a reed-built trimaran is displayed in the Lima Archaeological Museum. The boat's hulls move independently, rising and falling to conform to the waves in the rapids. Safety regulations on the rivers demand that a small mariner outboard is used for steering. It also provides propulsion when the suitable winds are absent. Without this, the journey would be extremely long. But as the expedition's aim is to test the hull, it is not worried about using some modern propulsion. As admiral of the fleet of boats, Jim Masters has a crew of 15 on Kota Mammoth 3, and her skipper is Sapper Captain Matt Wilkinson. Bolivian mahogany boats are used to carry other personnel, stores, and the expedition headquarters.
Oh, I like this music.
And we did hit one of those, but it was submerged and it certainly stopped the boat. Some turns on the inside of the bend, there's a beach. All silt's been deposited.
This footage had been flooded for 4 months this year, would you believe? And the place was a bit of a mess. So here's his family, and look, the rest of the family are coming in. Look, they're in the bottom there. So we just stopped at this village, and we're now on our way down to the next stop. There's Kota Mammoth. Quite a substantial house here by the look of it, so...
Yeah, we've already got the kit. But it continues to cause problems with the drone. We've got to go to the
drone and have a look at it. Beautiful, really, isn't it?
So this is where they're cooking up a meal, and dogs underneath, pigs, and a little pig. Look at him. So we've got a little bit of pasture in there. It's almost this, almost looks better than what we're getting. And hot water in there. Looks as if there's some sausages there. Water on, and could be the Sunday roast in the back there. Having a day early because I think it's Saturday today. Okay.
Dentist Graham Catchpole is never short of patients. Sugar cane takes a terrible toll of a people's teeth, and few can afford a dentist.
Mamma mia, 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 mamma mia,
Yeah. I'm just, it's called a luxator. If you look at that, you push that up between the tooth and the bone, and it just, if you wriggle it around a bit, it just splays the bone out. And then, with a bit of luck and a fair wind, these will go up in the same clay as well. You know, I've got it loose. But it is quite rotten if you want to come in and look at it. I've got well up in here, so. Sorry. Okay, bravo. Oh, look at that abscess on it. Close up. All that soft. There, look. Look at that, size of a pea.
Doing a little bit of last minute cleaning by the look of it.
Dr. Sam Allen's medical team are also hard at work and give what aid they can during the stops.
So at that time he's had the yellow stuff
came out. It may be that it all stems from that.
And we're just patching up the
After the mountains, the fleet sails on down the winding Rio Beni. There are plenty of fish for the pot.
So there you have one of these piles of wood and debris you get on this river all the time.
A Bolivian army band welcomes the fleet to the little river port of Cachuela Esperanza. Here, the only major cataract on the Rio Beni awaits them. Many have died in the tossing waves of the cataract, and local people are eager to see if the crazy explorers will be able to shoot it successfully. An aerial reconnaissance shows the cataract is straight and unobstructed, so Jim and Matt are confident that Cotamama 3 will get through. Thank you.
pilots in board. North station smashed. We are now entering the rapid. Out.
With its hulls rising and falling, the great reed boat rides magnificently, whilst the red ensign and the Bolivian flag fly proudly from the stern and bow.
As we speak to the skipper, Mr. Wilkinson, how did that go?
Good. Cheers, Jack. Yeah, fine. I think the only casualty was the radio.
Oh, well, not to worry. Yeah. One less, only six to go.
Yeah.
We're turning back now. Here we go.
Some days later, after battling with a number of rapids, Kota Mammoth 3 faces a very difficult cataract, Ribeiro. With 13 men and one woman in her crew, Matt steers his craft along the tongue. But the current is carrying them too far to the left, and now they face a gaping 15-foot deep hole in the river. There is nothing they can do to avoid it, and simply hang on for dear life and pray. Plunging down into the hole, the boat is hurled backwards by a massive stopper wave. 11 of the crew are thrown overboard. With two of its hulls capsized, the stricken craft is swept out of control into a second stopper wave. Amazingly, the central hull rights itself. The port outrigger's forward securing cable has snapped, and the boat is a twisted wreck. Avon safety boats rescue the half-drowned swimmers. Take off the few who have managed to stay aboard the wrecked craft.
Son recuerdos de romance que una vez juntos empezamos tú y yo y sin razón olvidamos.
Sort of thoughts. Where do you think we might find the boat?
I don't think it's gone further than we've got a small town called Abuna, which is about 60k down from where we had the accident site.
Yalima has found an aircraft to take John Blashford Snell and Matt to search for the wreckage.
So we have just located Kota Marma, and very conveniently it's down at an airbase, and we've just dropped into the airfield, and we're just going down to have a look at it. It really is a stroke of luck. And it looks all right, I have to say, from the air. Everything's the right way up and together, so I think these chaps have recovered it down here. So let's go down and see.
The previous night, the Bolivian Navy, watching for drug runners, had seen this strange craft with its jaguar figureheads coming out of the darkness and promptly arrested it. Apart from a twisted tail or two, the trimaran is virtually undamaged, and John calls up Maximo Katari on the nearer sat phone.
Okay, let's go. But Maximo Katari has done just that. He bought this bale of Totora reeds all the way from Lake Titicaca by air and by bus and by plane and everything else. And here he is now, and he's had a day's work on it, and he's managed to straighten out the stern post on the damaged port outrigger, and now he's going to be doing some work on the central hull. And although the boat won't look quite as it did originally, it's a very good attempt, and I think she'll sail just as well.
Do you think you could straighten the teeth out as well, or don't you think you have the expertise? Because that's my job. You can't do that. Not the teeth.
Okay.
You stick to the ears.
Okay, we'll stick with the ears, and you are going to come out to do the teeth.
Yes, that's right.
And then I will film you.
Oh, well, yes, okay.
Like that? Okay. 1, 2, 3, one more.
Oh! Wow! Okay, it looks difficult. Oh! Heave! Oh!
Ah. Okay.
Having portaged the remaining rapids, the expedition reassembles at Portobello in Brazil. Now, Kota Marma 3 is ready to face the Amazon and sail the remaining 1,600 miles to the Atlantic. New members have joined the team, and a new support boat is hired to carry the stores, medical personnel, and scientific members. John Blashford Snell has his headquarters and his communication center on the splendid Brazilian riverboat. The local navy and police come to wish the team farewell. The kindness of the people of Portobello will long be remembered. With their new support boat, the Capitan Azevedo, the fleet sets sail down the Rio Madeira, heading for the Amazon. The study of wildlife is an important part of the expedition's work, and in a remote lagoon a team sets off to locate a huge anaconda reported to be there.
Expedition.
Keep your heads down, boys. We're looking for an anaconda.
Yes.
This is another anaconda hunt. Keep your head down.
Head down.
Keep filming.
I feel it too.
Copy it.
You got to pay for that one.
Come on.
They find caiman, and then just the carcass of a 15-foot anaconda. You are Kumana are there too. Cormorants take off in front of the canoe. What else lurks there?
Keep your head down. Which way do we go next? Wow.
Suddenly, a large caiman appears. It must be 12 feet in length. An eagle watches them intently. Hawks are there too.
Puerto Cabina, no?
Puerto sí. Cabina.
Uh-huh. ¿A cuánto estará eso de acá cerca?
¿Hasta dónde el
viento?
Gibraltar. Ah,
Gibraltar. Good, look at him all. Incredible. Nearly jumped in the boat. So having taken a lot of their fish, I suppose they've got to go back and get some more, but they're absolutely massive around here. I'm not quite sure how they get them.
Along the length of the Rio Madeira, there are many lagoons and lakes, teeming with bird life, reptiles, and mosquitoes. The expedition biologist, Eric Nimi, is in a demi-paradise. Many local people live on their boats. Near Santarem, the expedition sees spectacular rock paintings. They are believed by some experts to indicate that the first people of South America were not descended from the North American plains hunters. Some say they may have come from Africa. Watched by scores of water birds, the fleet sails on. The damaged outrigger has become too waterlogged and Jim has to abandon it. Thus, Kota Member 3 has become a catamaran. The Santarem skipper of our support vessel had little knowledge of the tidal conditions as the fleet approaches the mouth of the Amazon, and eventually he runs onto a sandbank. As the tide recedes, the vessel heels over, much to the amusement of the locals. On board, the team holds a party, and soon do not notice the 20-degree list. At last, the tide comes in and floats the vessel free. Late that night, she grounds again.
Dawn is just
river pirates attack a ferry ahead of the fleet, and Captain Marcelo Mendes, the Brazilian naval liaison officer with the expedition, informs the Admiral of the Amazon. A gunboat soon appears to see that the fleet comes to no harm. But some 2 weeks later, pirates near here murdered the international yachtsman Sir Peter Blake. On the 5th of September, the fleet sights Belém, at the mouth of the mighty Amazon. Here, the river is 200 miles wide. So after almost 3,000 miles, the dear old bale of straw has reached the ocean. Coming from the Andes to the Atlantic, she has shown that ancient people could have done it. En route, the team found stone axe heads of andesite, found only in the Andes. This indicates that trade did exist, and when local sailing craft was seen being pushed upstream by prevailing winds, it was realized that earlier traders could have returned home. Many archaeological sites have been studied, wildlife catalogued, and much aid given to the people. At Belém, students from the Cultura Inglesa College, dressed as British guardsmen in red uniforms, welcome the expedition, and the Brazilian Navy band played them in. A special letter from Her Majesty the Queen awaits them. Kota Mammoth 3 was then given to the Brazilian Navy, and the balsa raft Southern Gales that had also made the 3,000-mile journey was shipped to England. The team returned home, but some were delayed in New York on the 11th September, and one only missed being in the World Trade Center because he stopped for breakfast. As Capitan Ayala of the Bolivian Navy said after the Ribeiro capsize, God looks after little children and mad people.
Yeah. Thank you.